have two great speakers. So let me introduce the first one. She's Maria De Martino, and she's going to talk about a hot topic. So the persistence of IgG response to SARS-CoV-2. So Maria, you can share the screen and the stage is yours.
Thank you, Chiara. Okay, you can see the screen.
Yes.
Okay. Just one moment. I want to hide the faces of Zoom, but I'm having some problems. Okay. Okay, so hello everybody. My name is Maria De Martino, and I study mathematics at the University of Trieste. And now I have a research grant at the University of Udine, in particular in the Division of Mathematical Statistics. So, medical statistics. Medical statistics is completely new for me, as it will be for you. But anyhow, I'm starting to know this word. So I'm collaborating with a lot of doctors in a lot of different fields. For example, I'm working with cardiologists, rheumatologists, but the main work that I'm doing is the one with the infectivology of Udine. So as you can imagine, the main important work is the one about COVID. So I will present to you what I'm doing about the study of COVID. So the main motivation of my study is to assess long-term serological response against SARS-CoV-2. What I mean by this, I mean that we want to study what is the distribution of the, also what is the immunity of a patient who recovers from COVID, because this, as Chiara said before, is a really hot topic because we are interested in knowing how does gonna behave the immunity of a patient who recovered from COVID, and also is gonna be a patient have immunity, because it's something that it must be not taken for granted. And this is really important right now, also because of the vaccine, because there are a lot of questions like, does a patient who had COVID need to take the vaccine? Anyway, so these are the motivation of my study, but also the other motivation is to assess the prevalence of factors that are associated with the post-coronavirus disease 6 months after the first wave. So since the coronavirus is a new virus, we don't know anything about it. We are also interested in knowing if there are gonna be some symptoms persisting after recovering from COVID. So it's a new field, completely new, and there is a lack of information. So this is the other motivation of the study that me and my team are doing. Anyway, since we are talking about coronavirus, I have to give an introduction about what is coronavirus. I think that an introduction is really stupid because we live with COVID, we know what it is anyway. For a sense of complete, I want to tell you. So SARS-CoV-2 is a positive sense single-stranded RNA virus, which is contagious in human. It was first identified in Wuhan, China, in December 2019. This SARS-CoV-2 causes coronavirus, and the symptoms of COVID include fever, cough, fatigue, dyspnea, dysgeusia, and other symptoms most severe like lung involvement. So the key questions are for me, what is the characterization of the long-term dynamics in the sense of an immune response to SARS-CoV-2? And what is the characterization of the post-COVID syndrome? With post-COVID syndrome, we include all the symptoms that can be linked to had COVID and that are persisting after recovering from COVID. So anyway, first of all, I have to explain how does a study in the clinical world function. It's new for me. I'm starting to learn this thing, and they are really interested because in order to start a study, you need to write a protocol. A protocol is an essay in which you say which is the goal of your study. Are you going to do the study? Are you going to collect the data? What are the steps of this study? And then the protocol must be approved. Also, in this case, there was a protocol, and it was a prospective cohort study that was designed at the hospital in Udine, Santa Maria Misericordia. Prospective means that you decided to do the study, and then you start to collect the data. For example, a retrospective study is a study that is done in the past, which means that maybe you decide to study survival rate after some operation, and then you take that data from the past and you analyze them. Or also you want to study the efficacy of some drugs. Anyway, this is a prospective study. So the patient were patients older than 18, and they were in and out patient. In and out means patient that outpatient are the patients that were cured at home. So they did not have a bad COVID. Maybe they were also asymptomatic. And then the inpatient were the patients that were cured at the hospital. So they were dead, a more severe COVID. So these patients are from the first, so this is something that is stupid, but okay. In this data set, we have just the patient who survived the first wave, because we are interested in assess the post-COVID symptoms and also the distribution of the immunity after recovering from COVID. So they are from of the first wave, so from the 1st March to the 30th of May 2020. Why the 1st March? Because it's the day when the first case of COVID was identified in Udine. So patient must be willing to participate in the study. This is something that they always say in a protocol. A patient must be willing to participate. It's something that something stupid, but it's important because you cannot take information about a patient who doesn't want to be in the study. And so a data set with their clinical and demographic information was populated. With demographic information, I mean information like the age, the sex, comorbidities, the BMI, and something like this. And the clinical information are the information about COVID. So, for example, were they cured at the hospital? How severe was the COVID? The COVID is measured by a scale, which is called WHO, who measure how bad is the COVID and got from asymptomatic, so a patient who has COVID but has no symptoms, to critical COVID. Then other clinical information can be the viral shedding, so how long does a patient remain positive, and something like this. So anyway, the most important part of this data set are the antibody concentration. So what they did, it was that they took the antibody concentration, with antibody concentration I mean IgG and IgM, on a monthly follow-up for the first 4 months, and then after recovery, and then on the 6th, on the 8th, and on the 10th month after recovery. So we have data that goes from March 2020 to February 2021. It's important to say that this study is still continuing, so they are still taking the serological collection. Anyway, my dataset is limited to the 10 month. These information are really, really precious. So it's important to continue the study also now. Also, on the 6 month, the patient were called by a nurse and they were interviewed about their symptoms that were persisting after recovery. This dataset contained more than 600 patients. So it's a really big dataset, and I think the force of this dataset is that it's really heterogeneous because it contains patients that had a severe COVID, but also patients that were just asymptomatic. So we have a different type of this situation. But now there are some problems, even though this dataset is really interesting, there are some big problems, which are the missing values. In fact, there are missing values in the serological collection, which means that some patients did not show up at the Monti follow-up. Why is that? Because this is something that it's happening a lot in the clinical studies, because patients did not show up. They don't go at the hospital because they are afraid of COVID. So in our case, there are a lot of missing values. And also there is another problem. In order to state this problem, I have to explain what does seronegative and seroneverse show means. A seronegative patient is a patient who never develops immunity. Immunity is having an IgG greater or equal than 10. So that's what it means to have immunity. So there are patients who don't develop immunity. This is something really important to stress because it's not, I think also in the media is something that it's a lot misunderstood because it's not so straightforward to have immunity after having COVID. Some patients never develop immunity. And so this is also important for the vaccine because saying that a patient who recover from COVID don't have to take the vaccine, it's something that is wrong. I mean, it's necessary a serological test of their IgG and IgM. Anyway, also seroreverted patients are patients who lose their immunity. So seronegative patients and patients who experience seroreversion were excluded from the serological follow-up. And why is that? Because doing a follow-up is really expensive, and also it takes the necessity of doctors. So it's having, as I said before, 600 patients, it's really difficult to do this follow-up for more than a year. So they decided to send home the patient who were seronegative. This has sense for them because they're interested in knowing how long does a patient maintain immunity. So when the IgG goes below the threshold of 10, they were not interested. But this is a problem for me that I have to study the distribution of IgG and IgM because I need all the value, even though they are below the cutoff of 10. So, as you can imagine, this is a real problem. But luckily, there were some bright aspects because some patients, even though they were below the cutoff of 10, they continue to go to their serological follow-up. I don't know why they do that, but they did. So my dataset, anyway, has a lot of value, even value that are below the cutoff of 10. Anyway, there are a lot of missing value. We have thought about how handling this problem. we have thought about imputes missing values with the mean, median, or some machine learning methods. Anyway, for now, also because the missing values are a lot, we decided to stick to the simple solution. Maybe, probably in future, we will use other solutions, but for now, we just stick to the simple one, which are the following. The first solution is the most clinical one, I would say, because we decided to define two new variables, which are antibody persistence of IgG and antibody persistence of IgM. They count the days between the day IgG or IgM were last detected. And by this, I mean having an IgG greater or equal than 10. And the day of acute onset of infection. Why is that? Because the IgG and the IgM start to grow when the infection is on the acute phase. So we have two continuous variables, which are the day, which are measured in days. This is the most clinical one because it just says how long does a patient maintain his immunity. Just as you know, antibody persistence of IgG in general is longer than antibody persistence of IgM. And why is that? Because IgM are a type of antibodies that start to grow very rapidly after the infection, but they also decrease more rapidly than the IgG. So in general, if you want to focus on the immunity, we have to focus on the IgG because they have more memory about the disease and they are more trustworthy, I would say. So this is what was the first solution. The second solution is just to focus on the subgroup of patients that have all the measurements along time in order to assess the distribution of IgG and IgM. So for the first case, the case with antibody persistence of IgG and IgM, we just use a linear regression. There is a linear approach to model the relationship between a scalar response and one or more explanatory variables. So we have that y is the scalar response, and then X is the covariate matrix for the intercept beta. In our case, Y is represented by the antibody persistence, and the possible covariates are the clinical and demographic information available for each patient. For example, the sex, age, comorbidities, and all the clinical information. Okay, this is a real simple method, but anyway, it gives a really interesting overview of how are the factors that affect the antibody persistence of IgG. So what are the factors that affect the immunity? And the results are very, very interesting. But anyway, when I decided to do this talk, I was hoping that the work that I was doing would be published right now, but this is not the case. It's under review, so I cannot tell you what are the results of my study, but I can show you results from other study because being an hot topic, everyone is studying about IgG and IgM. For example, I can show you this image that shows the time that is taken to some patient to become seropositive. Okay, this is a work about, I think, 100 patients that were cured at the hospital. So they have a more severe COVID. In fact, as you can see here, there is the proportion in the first image. There is the proportion of patient that became seropositive. Seropositive means gain the immunity. So having an IgG bigger or equal than 10, IgG or IgM. As you can see, all the patients gain immunity. And why is that? Because normally patients that are more severe, they gain immunity. I mean, their IgG start to increase anyway. So by the image, we can see that by the 38 days, 95% of the population gained the immunity. But the time to seroreversion is different because we don't have the seroreversion of the IgG. And why is that? As you can see, the follow-up is short because they follow the patient until 112 days. So they still don't know when this patient lose the immunity because, as I've told you before, the immunity stays of IgG stays longer than, for example, the immunity of IgM. In fact, as you can see here, by the 101 days, 95% of their population lose the immunity of IgM. My follow-up is longer, but I cannot show you the result. Anyway, this is also why I'm saying that 10 months are really interesting to is a follow-up that is really interesting to study. Okay, so going to the second part, which is the one in which we focus on the subgroup of patients with all the measurements. In this case, we decided to use a linear mixed model. A linear mixed model is a generalization of a linear regression. But in this case, we also take into account the random deviation. The random deviation is given by the fact that the IgG are taken a long time for each patient. So there are repeated measures of the same patient. So we have to take into account the random effect given by this patient. This effect, as we can see in this formula, is given by ZU, where Z is the covariate matrix for the random effects U. In our case, for example, if we consider Y to be the IgG, we have, for example, that the fixed effect is given by beta zero plus beta 1 month, where the month goes to 1 to 7. Why is that? I always tell 10, but because we have the first 4 months, then the 6, the 8, and the 10th month. And then we have the term UJ, that is the random effect given by the patient. So in this case, the covariate is the month, because we want to see how are the IgG gonna distribute, are they gonna assess depending on the month, but also we can see with other factors, for example, the age, number of comorbidities, WHO, and so on. So this is really interesting because we can really see how is the distribution of IgG and IgM a long time depending on some factor. If we can see if these factors are associated with maybe a decrease of IgG a long time. So we are interested in see if a patient who had a more severe COVID will have IgG for a longer time or maybe a shorter time. And so in this case also, we can start to making prediction about, because what is the interesting part? Why is that? The fact is that we want to see how long does a patient maintain immunity, because we want to know if this patient maybe does need to get the vaccine, because maybe we take this serological sample and the patient has immunity, but the question is, how long does this patient gonna have immunity? This is an open question, and we are trying to study this. So, anyway, the last part of my study is the post-COVID syndrome, which is last but not less important. In fact, it is also an interesting topic because it's something that is still unknown. We are beginning to study this. For example, what are anyway the symptoms of acute COVID? They are cough, fever, dyspnea, myalgia, joint pain, fatigue, anosmia, dysgeusia. But the question is, does these symptoms persist after recovery? In this case, for example, we have a study that was published in JAMA in 2020, and it's an Italian study, I think, in Milano. They have this data about 100 patients that recover from COVID, and they have called this patient again to see how were they doing after 2 months. As you can see by the image, 50% of the patients still have fatigue. 40% of the patients still have dyspnea. So it's really, coronavirus really have an impact on the health of the patient, even if they recover from coronavirus. So it's something that it's important to study, and what we are interested in is what are the factors that are associated to having post-COVID syndrome. In my case, we have data about symptoms after 6 months. And in assess which are the factors associated, I'm using a logistic regression. The logistic regression is a regression with a response variable that has value 0 or 1, which means having symptoms or not having symptoms after 6 months. And so I'm studying which are the factors associated. But being my study under review, unfortunately, I cannot go into further detail. Anyway, yes, it's really interesting to study what are the factors that are associated to this post-COVID syndrome. So, okay, I thank you for the attention, and yeah, this is it.
Thank you, Maria. It was a great talk. So we have a few questions.